Final item of business today is a member's business debate on motion number 15741 in the name of Cara Hilton on childcare costs spiralling in Scotland. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I invite those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And if you're ready, Ms Hilton, please open the debate. You have 7 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. One of the biggest challenges facing mums and dads in my Dunfermline constituency and in communities right across Scotland is childcare. The cost of childcare, the quality of childcare and the availability and flexibility of childcare. It's particularly ironic that we are debating this issue in the evening because right now in Scotland there's virtually no childcare available for mums and dads who work at nights, who work at weekends, who work in hours that don't fit in with what's on offer for most childcare providers, or indeed when working hours change from one day to the next, as they seem to be doing in Parliament over recent weeks. Like many mums with three children of primary school age, I only managed to juggle childcare due to a combination of out-of-school care, granny and grandma, friends and my husband, but not everyone has got this support network. While childcare challenges certainly don't end when your children start school, at least when your children are in school, the days of paying out more for childcare than for your rent or your mortgage are largely over. But Scottish parents still face an average school club bill of £53 a week for each child. And according to the Family and Childcare Trust survey, school club bills have risen by 8.5% in the last year alone for parents in Scotland. Looking at preschool childcare, the Family and Childcare Trust have found that the average cost of 25 hours childcare for a child aged 0 to 2 is £111 a week in a nursery or £102 a week with a childminder. The figure reduces only slightly for children aged 2 and over. Many parents who have more than one child in childcare will be paying double that or more. A parent with two children under the age of 5 will be paying a staggering £900 a month for 25 hours childcare. That adds up to over £10,000 a year. If a parent works full-time and needs full-time childcare, the sum will be higher still. And with the nursery costs for over two-year-olds up 4.1% last year in Scotland, faster than anywhere else in the UK outside London, the bills keep on rising. The cost of childcare is the biggest single bill parents face, and it's little surprise that for many mums and dads, faced with such high childcare costs, there is little option but to reduce their hours at work or give up their job or career altogether. This impacts not just on parents, but on our society and on our economy. Many parents will struggle along and end up in debt, with a report by Save the Children finding that a third of low-income parents get into debt to pay for childcare. Other families find the money by cutting back on food, day trips and holidays. Many more only manage by working opposite shifts, undermining family life and home relationships. But it's not just about cost. The Family and Childcare Trust research found that just 13% of Scottish local authorities have got enough childcare to meet the needs of working parents. This contrasts with England, where 45% have got enough childcare, and Wales, where 40% have got enough. And things are getting worse because... yes.
Liam MacArthur.
Well, to Cara Hilton for taking intervention on that specific point. Does she agree that it would be helpful as a next stage forward if local authorities were under some obligation at least to map the provision in their areas so that the level of need that is being unmet could then be quantified and steps taken to address it?
I think Liam MacArthur must have seen my speech already because I'll be turning to that shortly. But things are getting worse because that figure is down 2% on last year and it compares with 23% in 2014. And it's a concern too that just 9% of local authorities have got enough childcare for parents with disabled children. Only 4% can cater for parents with atypical work patterns. And all of this highlights why there is an urgent need for a genuine national oversight of childcare policy to ensure that the needs of parents in Scotland can be met. Despite the obligation in the 2014 Children and Young People's Act for local authorities to consult and publish plans for childcare for both under-fives and out-of-school care, 16 local authorities in Scotland told the Family and Childcare Trust that they had no information about local childcare supply and parental demand for it. If local authorities and providers have little knowledge of the needs of local parents, then how can they intervene to meet the gaps in the provision? Presiding Officer, it was Scottish Labour that first introduced free early learning and childcare for 3- and 4-year-olds. And my motion today welcomes the Scottish Government's extension to 600 hours. But the reality is that while this is great for children's development, it's got very little impact on the childcare costs of the majority of working parents. Few jobs fit around a space available 3 hours a day during term time only. Many parents continue to pay a childminder or nursery while their child is using their free space, and often this is the only way that they can keep the childminder or private nursery space available. Other parents are unable to access their free hours at all due to the work patterns and lack of free spaces available in private nurseries, and also a lack of enthusiasm that many councils have in allowing childminders to become partner providers. The Fair Funding for Our Kids campaign has found that as many as 1 in 5 children are not getting the place they're entitled to. And this has been backed up by the National Day Nurseries Association, who say that 43% of private nurseries have had the number of free places that they can offer to parents capped. On average, there's a waiting list of 11 children for each free space that children are entitled to but can't access. So right across Scotland, thousands of parents are unable to access a free entitlement because of the lack of flexibility that still exists. And it's a concern that the Family and Childcare Trust report finds little evidence to suggest action has been taken to address this. I know that the Minister is well aware of these issues and is as keen to find a solution as me, but it's frustrating for mums and dads already juggling work and family and childcare to listen to politicians in here who say that parents are hundreds of pounds a year better off thanks to free childcare, when quite often the spin doesn't reflect the reality of parents' lives, because the reality for parents right across Scotland is that childcare costs are spiralling faster than anywhere else in the UK outside London. The cost of a nursery place has risen up to 30% in Scotland over the course of this Parliament. Presiding Officer, last year the Commission on Childcare Reform set out a bold vision for the transformation of childcare, and the Family and Childcare Trust have also urged urgent reform of the system. I would like to highlight too the Fair Funding for Our Kids proposal for a 10-year plan to transform childcare in Scotland. We know that investment in quality and affordable early learning in childcare is crucial, not just because it makes work pay, because it helps close the attainment gap and it also supports our economy and employers. And yet, well, it seems that we all want to see change, and no one more than mums and dads that are faced with huge childcare bills. Once more, the debate in Scotland has been shaped by point scoring over 3 hours. In May's election, parents have been promised more free childcare, with a doubling of 3 hours for 3- and 4-year-olds by 2020. And I don't have time now to discuss the challenges of making this happen. But experts, providers, academics, children's organisations, and above all parents, agree that childcare has to be about affordability, quality and flexibility, as well as 3 hours. In conclusion, Scotland needs a childcare policy designed to fit around the lives of working parents, not designed to fit an election leaflet or a pledge card. It's not just about 3 hours, good as they are. We need a childcare system that supports parents with children of all ages, a system that recognises that childcare challenges don't end when children start school, which supports parents with babies and toddlers, not just preschoolers, which puts affordability and flexibility at its heart, supporting working parents and our economy too. So whatever the result in May, I hope that we can work together across political divide to deliver the childcare revolution that Scotland's families need and that Scotland's children deserve.
Many thanks. Now call on George Adam to be followed by Ian Graham. Ian Gray, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, President Officer.
Or a generous 4 minutes, even. Yep.
I'd like to thank Cara Hilton for bringing this important debate to the Chamber here tonight, and for some of the things that she said with how do we move forward and how do we work together in order to deliver for the families throughout Scotland. And, you know, as far as I'm concerned, we're actually coming from a place where the Scottish Government already has an ambitious programme to give children in Scotland the very best start in life. And raising the amount of free childcare for 3- and 4-year-olds, which Cara Hilton already mentioned, from 415 hours to 475 hours and now to 600 hours can make a difference. And there's also the fact that vulnerable 2-year-olds will be included in that as well. And the Scottish Government is delivering for our families. You know, they receive the same provision. Our plans are ambitious, and the First Minister has recently went on record and saying that she sees the biggest capital spend and investment in the future would actually be in childcare. It's not as easy to show like a big shiny new bridge and a road infrastructure project, but it's something that makes a big difference to families throughout our country and our nation. And I think when you see that on top of that, obviously the Scottish Government already wants, if it's an SNP government next time round, to increase the hours up to 1140 hours before the end of the next parliamentary session. And when I was talking about the capital spend, we're talking about £170 million worth that could be invested. So that can make a difference. You know, I've also got a personal part to this as well, because I've obviously, I know I look too young to be a grandparent, but I am a grandparent, and my granddaughter Daisy, my daughter Jessica, is actually going back to education, and she's looking at care in order to make sure that she can actually ensure that she can go back to education. And obviously Daisy's just coming up for 1.5, but eventually when she's 2, 3, they'll get the opportunity. But I can understand on a very practical level how difficult it can be for families, but the government is doing what it can to actually make sure that that can make a difference within local areas. And some of the facts and figures that Cara Hilton brought up with regards to the cost of childcare, it's just not the case in Scotland that the average weekly cost of childcare of 24 hours for nurseries is in England £113, and in Scotland it's £104. So there is an example of where it's cheaper for Scotland as well. And if you look at 50 hours per week, it's a regional average in England of 221, and in Scotland it's £203. So although the cost are quite a bit for families to deal with, it's still not as bad as what others were saying. And the investment that the government is planning on making, I see that as being the exciting part of this debate. The fact that we'll be moving on to a situation where we can actually, and ironically from my own, to declare an interest even more, as my daughter plans to actually go back to be trained as a nursery nurse. So it's effectively, you know, part of the government's investment is ensuring that young women like her get the opportunity, and young men as well, to possibly get involved in that industry as well. And I think that's part of the debate we've got to remember. We've got to build that infrastructure. We've got to build it to a stage that we can ensure that we can deliver for all the families in Scotland. So at this stage, we have the commitment from the Scottish Government. We have movement in the hours that we're going, and we have the investment. The only thing is to see how we take it to the next stage forward and ensure that we do actually deliver, Presiding Officer, for all the young people and families in Scotland.
Many thanks. Now calling Ian Gray to be followed by Mary Scanlon. 4 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And firstly, I want to congratulate Cara Hilton for bringing this evening's debate. It is a critical issue for families, and the figures in the Family and Childcare Trust report to which the motion refers are both dramatic and damning, they show really that in Scotland childcare is unaffordable. It's getting more unaffordable, and it's more unaffordable in Scotland than it is in the rest of the UK, in spite of the gloss Mr Adams tried to put on that. And there are real consequences for families across Scotland. Cara Hilton went in some detail through some of the ways in which families try to deal with this, but there are probably two fundamental ways in which families try to deal with unaffordable childcare. One is that one parent, usually the mother, simply does not work, gives up work or isn't able to take up work, with all the consequences that that has for the family income and for their career prospects into the future. And the second strategy, which is often pursued, is by grandparents taking the strain. And last year, I think it was, the report the Family and Childcare Trust produced, they surveyed how much childcare was provided by grandparents and discovered that the majority of grandparents in Scotland actually provide some support for childcare, and that figure was much higher in Scotland than it was in the rest of the UK. So we should ask ourselves, how did we get to this? And we know how we got to this, because the Childcare Alliance undertook a significant piece of work when they set up their commission into the reform of childcare, the commission that Cara Hilton referred to. And they were very, very clear about where we had gone wrong on childcare in recent years. And they said that the single-minded focus on preschool free hours to the exclusion of all else had had policy consequences which were detrimental for other and necessary forms of childcare. And providers too have said to us in recent weeks that the underfunding of free childcare places has meant that additional costs have been passed on to those parents and families who are paying for their own childcare or for the additional hours that they need in order to work full time. The Childcare Alliance were absolutely clear that what families need is childcare which is flexible all year round, all age, and affordable, not just free. And there is no reason why we cannot deliver that, because other countries do it. Other countries provide childcare in a way which means that childcare arrangements don't come to a grinding halt three times a year when the school holidays start. And childcare, which they know will not bankrupt them because there is a limit on what proportion of their income they will have to spend on childcare. And these countries don't invest more public funds than we do. So they invest similar amounts of funds and they get much more back for it. So really, the onus, it seems to me, on the Minister is to take the opportunity this evening to at least signal a shift in the government's thinking, that they will go into this election not simply boasting about free preschool hours, which after all on many occasions in recent years has been about playing catch-up with the rest of the United Kingdom, but rather that they will present to us a plan to move forward to see the transformation in childcare which families in Scotland want and need and which we can do if we have the political will to do it.
Many thanks. Now Colin Mary Scanlon, after which we'll move to the closing speech.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Now, I would also like to thank Cara Hilton, because I think any opportunity to debate childcare early years is very, very welcome. And I think in this institution we talk about higher education, schools, etc. And I am no doubt after more than a couple of decades in this Parliament that the most important part of the education process is preschool. So I thank her for bringing this forward. In her motion, the figure that jumped out at me was in Scotland only 13% of local authority areas report having enough childcare for working parents, 13%, and only 9% can provide childcare for disabled children. The other point that I took from the Care Inspectorate report, I've read a few reports in advance of today, was the children attending early learning in urban areas, 29%, and in remote and rural areas, 13%. And as an MSP for the Highlands and Islands, I think there are many, many people missing out simply because of transport and other issues. Talking about missing out, my colleague Liz Smith has spoken over many years about the fact that some people get six terms of free childcare preschool and others get four. So the 600 hours for 2 years is also quite misleading, because if you're born, if the child is born between 1st of March and the end of August, they'll get six terms. If they're born between 1st September and the end of December, they'll get five terms. And if they're born between the 1st of January and the last day of February, they'll get four terms. Now, I thought that was odd, and I know Liz Smith has pointed it out quite regularly, but what I hadn't appreciated was that in the statutory guidance, paragraph 68, there are arrangements to commence closer to the child's third birthday, encouraged to support the longer-term aims to increase the amount of early learning. But I understand this is at the discretion of local authorities. However, I further understand they wouldn't receive any additional funding. So I think if we look for a fair system where everyone gets 2 years preschool, we have to also look at the additional funding. But the report that Cara Hilton has mentioned regularly today, the Family and Childcare Trust, the 13% of local authorities providing enough childcare for working parents, that compares with 43% in England. So we're not just 1 or 2% behind England. Ian Gray talked about catching up. England are three times higher than we are, and I think that that is really an issue that the Minister, I hope she will address today, and I do think that we are addressing that over the longer term. And when it comes to costing, George Adam mentioned over 1,000 hours, and the Nicola Sturgeon did say that she would double the childcare funding to 439 to 880. Now, having spent 5 years in the audit committee, how does she know it's going to cost 880? Will it cost more? Will it cost less? Now, where does that figure come from? If everyone was able to take up the childcare, it may cost so much more. Just because you double the figure does not mean that it is an adequate figure to use. I would also, in this debate, in the short time I have left, just like to mention the fact, I think it was a hustings I was at probably less than a year ago, where I heard that councils across Scotland pay varying rates to independent nurseries for childcare. Now, some were receiving £5 per hour per child. Others were receiving less than £3. Now, that leads me on to my next point, because I think another thing in this Parliament, we have never, ever valued properly the contribution that childcare, early years, nursery staff make. They are more qualified. They are registered with the Scottish Social Services Council. The care inspectorate are rigorous in their inspections. The quality is excellent. And I think we need to fund the councils, and councils need to fund the nurseries. And above all, we need to value the staff that look after children day after day in Scotland. Thank you.
Many thanks. Now call the Minister, Aileen Campbell, to close the debate on behalf of the Government. 7 minutes thereby. Please, Minister.
Okay, thank you, Presiding Officer. And again, like everyone else who's contributed this evening, I'd like to thank Cara Hilton for bringing the important debate to Parliament. And while we do have differences, it's important, I think, in the closing remarks that she made in her speech, that we do work together on areas of commonality. And like Cara, I have a young family, and it's not a necessity that you have to have a young family to understand the pressures of family life, but it is a practical lived experience of the challenges that many families face across the country. And I am delighted to have an opportunity to debate childcare, because this government has been ambitious in terms of what we want to do to work to ensure all our children get the best possible start in life and to make a significant difference for future generations of families. And we have massively expanded early learning and childcare by almost half, from 412.5 hours a year to 600 hours a year. And we have all committed to almost doubling this again to 1,140 hours per year by the end of the next Parliament. And that's equivalent to the number of hours that a child spends at school. And it has to be focused. The reason we focus on hours is because we want to ensure that that is configured in a much more flexible way in response to what families need. And in response to the points that Ian Gray made around the cost of childcare, Scotland's average weekly cost of childcare for both 25 hours and for 50 hours a week in terms of early learning childcare are lower in every single area in comparison to England and the rest of the UK. So Scotland's childcare costs are lower, and what we are doing is trying to ensure that we are providing the resource that's necessary to help families even further, because we've fully funded this expansion already, £500 million in the first 3 years, and far from cutting expenditure, we have invested unprecedented levels of capital, £170 million to front-load infrastructure changes, with local authorities receiving their final £30 million instalment in 2016-17, as agreed with COSLA. And it's absolutely vital that the full funding allocated by the Scottish Government is prioritised on the transformation that we seek over the next Parliament, because this money is money well invested. With it, we are improving outcomes for all our children, especially those who will benefit most. We're supporting parents to work, train or study, especially those who need routes into sustainable employment. And we're reducing the burden of cost to parents, equivalent to saving £780 a year for those additional hours. Our ambitions go beyond simply increasing hours. Our aim is to develop high-quality, flexible early learning and childcare, which is affordable and accessible for all and is integrated with school and out-of-school care. And that's why the Children and Young People Act introduced for the very first time an entitlement for 27% of two-year-olds who will benefit most from early learning and childcare to make a significant contribution to closing the attainment gap and improving equality for all our children. And that's why we've also introduced for the first time a requirement on local authorities to provide choice and flexibility based on local consultations with parents, providing opportunities for employment support and family support. Because if we are serious about giving children the best possible start in life, then quality is non-negotiable. And I do agree that this doesn't have to just be about 3 hours, it has to be about quality and flexibility. In terms of quality, that is why we're making early learning and childcare part of the learning journey from birth, integrated with the earliest stages of curriculum for excellence. It's why we're supporting the development of an early learning and childcare workforce, which is, in response to Mary Scanlon, highly valued and based on specialist skills. It's why we're introducing additional graduates from 2018 to support children who will benefit most. It's also why we're creating a new standard of training and induction for childminders so that they can become integral to our expansion on funded entitlements. It's also why we're continuing to fund the universities of Aberdeen and Strathclyde to deliver early year specific master's qualifications for primary teachers to provide opportunities for teachers to specialise. And it's also why we're providing £1 million to invest in pilots of different types of early learning and childcare as a way of finding out what works well for families and children.
Mary Scanlon.
I wonder if I can ask, there's a significant range in the payments per hour per child from local authorities. I was quite shocked to know some were under £3, others were over £5. If we value the workforce, surely the nurseries have to be funded in order to financially value them as well. Is that something the government will look at?
Minister.
Well, I'm not sure of the point that Mary Scanlon is making. I'm not sure whether she's talking about the workforce or the funding that goes to private nurseries, which is something that's a cause of concern. It is an issue that we're looking at across the board. We've got a financial review that's looking into the cost of delivering childcare. And in terms of, and I'm not sure if the point she was making around the workforce was around their pay and terms and conditions, but certainly we want to respond to the challenges set out by Professor Siraj that looked at the workforce when we commissioned her, because we do absolutely have to recognise that the formative years in a child's life are the early years, and that this workforce is dealing with children at a very crucial point in their development. So we need to recognise them, speak loudly about the work that they do, and make sure that they're recognised across the piece. So in less than 3 years, we have delivered significantly on making this transformation a reality, and the Care Inspectorate published a report last week of an initial overview of implementation from June 2014 and concluded that local authority efforts have been considerable and that they have been and made significant achievement in making the new entitlements available. And of course, we are seeing improvement across local authorities, a number of local authorities who are responding to parental demand and the way in which they want to see their childcare delivered. And we're also seeing local authorities work with partners, which includes the third sector and private providers, in a number of innovative and different ways. For instance, Cala in the Highlands, perhaps Mary Scanlon will be familiar with them, are providing a wide range of innovative solutions and services in partnership with Highland Council. SEMA are supported and are promoting child minding with a number of different local authorities to ensure that flexibility is there for families that they're working with. Earlier Scotland is developing playgroup solutions and support for the involvement of parents in Dumfries and Galloway. NDNA has developed forums and partnerships with local authorities across the whole country, with a majority of local authorities now no longer stipulating session times from private nurseries. Glasgow City Council are trialling holiday cover, as well as creating 500 new partner providers. The Job Centre Plus are working to promote higher uptake, for example, in Inverclyde, and East Lothian and Mid Lothian are promoting outreach work for parents. And many local authorities, such as the one that Cara Hilton covers in Fife, are expanding and opening their own centres to full days year-round, with options for parents to purchase additional hours as well. So that's just some of the examples that are happening right across the country. But we're not complacent. And while the changes I've outlined are positive, there still remains challenges. Improvement is ongoing on flexibility, but we do need to be imaginative and innovative in the way in which we respond to the parental and family challenges that are existent for many across the country. We need to continue to engage and listen and respond and work with parents as partners in how we configure and develop the additional hours that we want to roll out over the next parliamentary session. And as George Adams said, the investment that we're making in this is significant, it's considerable, it's a mark of the seriousness by which this government takes childcare as a way to promote family cohesion, about allowing parents to go on and find ways to get training or job opportunities. And as the First Minister said, and she made it absolutely clear, that the biggest transformational investment over the next Parliament will not be a road or a bridge, but it will be the transformation of early learning and childcare, investing in the future of our children and families and creating real equality of opportunity for the future of our country. That does not demur from the challenges that exist and that we need to overcome. But I think if we do this in a collective way, using and drawing upon the areas in which we have common areas of interest, working together, we can make this transformation happen and deliver, importantly, for families and importantly for the children that we want to make sure have the best possible start in life.
Many thanks. Thank you all for taking part in this debate. I now close this meeting of Parliament.